So the future of agriculture is in this envelope. And before I tell you what's inside, I'd like to share an analogy with you. Imagine filling up the gas tank on your car. But before you even start the engine, that gas begins to leak out. And by the time you reach your destination, 40% of it is gone. And you'd be furious, right? Well, that's what farmers are experiencing every single year. They're paying for fuel, nitrogen, that's literally evaporating or getting washed away by the rain. So I'm Karsten Temme, co-founder at Pivot Bio, and I've spent my career studying this invisible yet crucial nutrient that is literally the fuel powering modern agriculture. We all know that plants need light and water to grow, but the other critical thing that all plants need is all around us. It's nitrogen. It's 78% of the air. But plants can't use it in that form. They need a chemical reaction to convert it from nitrogen gas into ammonia. It's a process called nitrogen fixation. For millions of years, this fixation was carried out by microbes in the soil. You see, when a plant photosynthesizes, it produces sugar. Some of that sugar is used to build biomass, and some is sent through the roots to feed microbes in the soil, like rhizobia and azotobacter. These microbes, in turn, fix nitrogen from the air and provide that ammonia, an essential nutrient, back to the plant. It's a beautiful, it's perfect, it's a symbiotic relationship, one that has sustained all life on Earth for millions of years. But as our population grew, we didn't need just more food. We needed more of, well, everything. So we bred crops that could provide more nutrients than the soil could provide. Enter fertilizer. A century ago, two brilliant scientists, Fritz Haber and Carl Bosch, figured out how to fix nitrogen artificially. Their invention, the Haber-Bosch process, uses hydrocarbons, often methane or coal, plus high pressure and high temperature to create ammonia. In creating synthetic nitrogen, they pulled the fuel to supercharge plant growth from the air. And I would argue that no discovery before or since has more profoundly affected our planet. Their work laid the foundation for the American agronomist Norman Borlaug to develop short-stemmed wheat varieties that could withstand heavier grain loads without breaking, allowing farmers to be able to use more fertilizer and increase their yields. Borlaug introduced these varieties to India and Pakistan, spawning the Green Revolution, potentially saving up to 1 billion lives, and forever changing the makeup of our diets. Today, half of the food we eat and nearly half of the entire global economy is supported by synthetic nitrogen fertilizers. But for all the good it did, synthetic fertilizer is an inelegant solution for meeting modern plants' increased nitrogen needs. For one thing, synthetic fertilizer shut down those nitrogen-fixing microbes in the soil. Like all living things, those microbes evolved to conserve energy. In the presence of excess nitrogen from synthetic fertilizers, they effectively downregulate their nitrogen-fixing function. When we add synthetic fertilizer to the soil, those microbes slam the brakes on their nitrogen production. Remember this for later. There's another issue with synthetic fertilizer, and it takes us back to that leaky gas tank analogy. In more ways than one, the nitrogen in the soil is like the gas in your car. Like oil, the geopolitics of fertilizer is complex and often volatile. Every year, the United States imports about 13% of the nitrogen fertilizer we use. That's nearly $5 billion worth. And it may sound like a lot, but we're actually relatively self-sufficient compared to other countries. Take Brazil. Another agricultural powerhouse, 95% of its nitrogen fertilizers are imported from countries like China and Russia as its major suppliers. This dependence on foreign sources leaves growers, along with the rest of the world, vulnerable to supply chain disruptions and price fluctuations. After Ukraine was invaded, the price of nitrogen fertilizer in the U.S. skyrocketed 300% to an all-time high. As the world's largest producer of fertilizer, Russia cut off its exports. That eliminated 15% of the world's supply. Think about what would happen if one of the major oil producers cut off its supply. We would expect the price of everything to go up. The same goes for fertilizer. You may not realize just how much the world depends on agriculture to drive the economy. Almost 45% of the global population relies on agriculture for their income. Yet a majority of what we grow doesn't end up on our plates. Instead, it's in everything else we use on a daily basis. It's in our clothes, it's in our building insulation. Which is why conversations about fertilizer, like conversations about oil, are at their core about our global economy and society. The similarities don't stop there. Remember how 40% of that nitrogen fuel leaks out of the gas tank? This leaked nitrogen doesn't just disappear. Some becomes nitrous oxide, which is a greenhouse gas 273 times more potent than carbon dioxide. Some seeps into our groundwater, and some washes into our rivers and oceans, creating more than 500 dead zones around the planet. For farmers, it's also a significant economic risk. Agriculture is inherently unpredictable. Will this season be too rainy or too dry? Or will a war on the other side of the world disrupt my supply chain? Growers live on the razor's edge between survival and failure. And what often determines their fate are factors outside of their control. So when a corn farmer spends nearly 40% of their operating budget on fertilizer, they're paying for a semblance of security in a deeply uncertain world. And while a farmer can control how much fertilizer they apply, they can't control how much they lose. And this loss comes at a cost, both for our planet and for the farmer's bottom line. The agriculture sector has been grappling with this issue for decades, and now we may finally have a solution. It starts back where we began 100 years ago. Nitrogen-fixing microbes have existed in soil for thousands and millions of years. Legumes like alfalfa, beans, lentils, they evolved over thousands of years to have a symbiotic relationship with nitrogen-fixing microbes. However, corn, wheat, rice, those crops that make up the majority of our diets, and other row crops like cotton, do not have that close and strong of a relationship with these microbes. Synthetic fertilizer was how we closed that nitrogen gap for these crops across the last century. But what if we could reawaken these microbes and put them back to work? Well, now we can, and here's how. Millions of microbes can be found in a sample of soil, but only some of these microbes have the ability to convert nitrogen in the atmosphere into plant-available ammonia. Scientists have identified ones like Cosaconia saccharide and Klebsiella verrucola that are safe, naturally occurring, and have a strong symbiotic relationship with row crops. They've studied the microbe's own genetic code, how it can help fix nitrogen and meet the nutrient needs of the crop, and with gene editing, enhance that natural strength by more than 1,000 times. Over the past 5 years, these microbes have been used by farmers to replace synthetic nitrogen fertilizers on more than 13 million acres. With reawakened microbes in the soil, scientists have found an effective way to fix nitrogen right at the plant roots. This provides a steady supply of that crucial nutrient throughout the growing season. And the best part? These microbes do so on demand in response to the plant's needs in real time. And unlike synthetic fertilizer, they don't wash away and they don't evaporate. They stay put, sticking to the roots of the plant. And instead of needing a massive semi to be able to deliver your fertilizer in the fall, all you need is seed that's been coated with what's in this envelope. One of my favorite parts of this job is getting to talk to farmers on a regular basis. And what they often say about fertilizer is, it's too expensive and it washes away, but I can't live without it. The status quo is not sustainable, both financially and environmentally. The good news is now we have the technology that the world needs to get the most out of both fertilizer and microbes. Our job is to partner to be able to bring this solution to farmers faster. I want to be clear. Without synthetic fertilizer, we would not have been able to feed a population that has been growing across the last 100 years. And we're going to need synthetic fertilizer for years to come. But as we face the challenges of climate change and a population that is expected to reach 10 billion by 2050, we need to evolve our approach. Like the transformation brought on by the first green revolution, this step change in our understanding of biology will bring both a future where farmers get better performing and more sustainable inputs, and get them at a price point that will continue to fall. The future of agriculture isn't choosing about productivity or sustainability. It's about finding solutions that deliver both. It's about working with nature, not against it. It's about reawakening the incredible potential that's been lying dormant in our soil for decades. Chemistry spawned the last agricultural revolution, and biology is starting the next one. And it can get delivered to you by FedEx. Thank you.